I'm really excited to tell you about what's coming up next. Now that we've heard from two senior government officials about how the federal government is perceiving all of these copyright issues, we thought it would be good to get a little closer to the ground and hear directly from musicians, songwriters, music managers, labels, copyright advocates. You know, it's obviously impossible to get everybody who has a stake in this stuff in this room, but we want to get a better sense of how folks who actually have skin in the game, who are doing things every day around copyright and technology, to just talk about how they're perceiving some of this stuff. And rather than just stick them all on one panel, we're going to do something a little bit unprecedented. At least I have not seen us present these concepts this way. We're going to have them talk directly to you in brief presentations or interpretive dances, and in their own words. And my advice to you is pay attention to what they're saying and see how that matches with your experiences in whatever, you know, part of the music community you occupy. And then after each presenter is done, we're going to take a couple questions. We probably won't have room to do a really long Q&A after everybody, but our friends are right here in the room. They're readily accessible, and you can follow up after with any other questions you might have. So I'm going to let everybody introduce themselves individually so I don't make a mockery of their CV. But first, we have Sandra Astars, from the executive director from Copyright Alliance. I had to actually say who she was because she's the first person coming up. Sandra, welcome.
So I didn't get the interpretive dance memo, otherwise I would have had my director of communications come and do this presentation. I am Sandra Astars, as Casey said, and I work for the Copyright Alliance. The Copyright Alliance, just so you know who we are, is a nonprofit public interest and educational organization. We're based here in DC, and we're made up of artists, creators, and innovators of all types. Our members include artist membership organizations and associations, unions, companies, guilds, and folks representing millions of creative individuals. And then we also collaborate with thousands of individuals and small businesses across the country who are part of our One Voice Activists Network. And I've found, especially in talking to people about this upcoming copyright review that's going on in Congress, that on core issues of copyright policy, there's so much more that unites creators, innovators, and artists of all types that it really makes it easy to represent this whole group in one organization, and that may come as a surprise to folks. I'm really grateful for the opportunity to speak to you today. I guess what I'd like to say about the ongoing copyright review is that we believe that it's fitting that in an age of rapid technological progress, we take some time out to examine our laws and encourage creativity and dissemination of works by setting up a framework of laws that work for artists and creators and then ultimately benefit the community at large. We think that the copyright laws on the whole are working and have helped make this creative community of ours here in the United States the leading producer and the exporter of creative and innovative goods in the world, but we understand the impetus for looking for areas where improvements could be made. In that vein, I want to underscore that in terms of what unites and divides various communities that speak about copyright issues, the creative community, which I represent, does not view copyright and technology as warring concepts in any way, shape, or form. We don't think that it's the sort of situation where you have to balance interests to further the public good. In fact, we think that we're partners and collaborators as creators with the technology community, and that in many ways, our individual creators and companies are actually playing dual roles, both as authors of creative works and as drivers of technological means to distribute those works. And often, I think you see the same from the technology community side, they are often straddling the line between creators and technologists at the same time. So I think there's the possibility to work well together. Regarding the copyright review, when people think about Congress reviewing the copyright laws, I think the tendency is to think immediately, well, we're going to roll up our sleeves and rewrite the entirety of Title 17. And I don't think that that's necessarily the most important work that the Judiciary Committee and the Copyright Office and the USPTO could do at this point. I think that the committee and USPTO and the Copyright Office working together could use their roles to encourage law enforcement to take seriously criminal violations of the existing copyright laws, to ensure that mechanisms like the DMCA notice and takedown provisions work effectively for everyone who has to use them, and that they can encourage all stakeholders in the internet ecosystem to proactively take commercially reasonable and technologically feasible measures to reduce the theft of intellectual property that goes on online without the need necessarily for legislation to do so. I think the principle from which I begin when I look at the copyright laws is that the copyright laws should be aimed at making the framework of laws work for authors so that they in turn benefit the culture at large by encouraging not just the creation of the creative works, but also the commercialization and dissemination of those works in the ways that the artists and authors see fit. Our grassroots members in particular have expressed concerns to us that these days there seems to be a trend to try to take the artist out of the value chain, out of the value proposition for their works, and to remove or lessen their rights or make them more difficult to obtain or maintain and enforce, and thus value accrues to others in the value chain and not the artist and the creator themselves. So looking at the review from that perspective, I guess I'd want to remind all of you that copyright is a unique form of property, that it's grounded in the artist's own creative work, their hard work, their talents, and in many ways it epitomizes the American dream. And I feel that I can speak to this, not because I'm terrifically creative and artistic myself, but because I grew up in a family where my father, an immigrant, both of my parents were refugees during World War II, and I'm a first-generation American. But my father raised us as a working visual artist and author. And most of the copyright owners in the U.S. are people who are just like my father. They're neither famous nor wealthy. They're not people whose name you're likely to recognize and to see, bandied about in the trade press. They're just individual graphic artists and photographers and songwriters and filmmakers and authors who make or supplement a middle class living with their creative works. And I think they are truly the creative force that is feeding the wealth of culture in our nation. So when the Judiciary Committee and others in the various government agencies delve into this process, we're urging them to think about copyright and innovation from an author's perspective in the following way. First, to think about the fact that copyright is about empowerment. Copyright belongs to the author from the time the work is created, and it is recorded in some tangible form, regardless of whether the author has registered it or not. And that is very important because a copyright might be the only asset that an author takes into a commercial negotiation with a distributor, with a label, or some other corporation. And it's what opens the door for an economic conversation. So if you weaken copyright or make it harder for the author to obtain or maintain its protections, you are weakening the author's negotiating position, as well as the value proposition, ultimately, that the distributor might be willing to pay for. Secondly, I'd say copyright is about choice, and Jacqueline talked about that as well. Copyright exists in a work, and it belongs to the author from the time that the work is recorded, and so it enables the author to choose what he or she wishes to do with it, and she can use a work in multiple ways simultaneously. You can license a work commercially to support yourself and to continue to invest in commercial projects, but also make the work available for free or to other non-commercial users to support causes that you believe in. And this allows for a broader variety of business models to develop and increases healthy competition in our marketplace and benefits both innovators and consumers. And in some instances, the author can choose not to license a work at all. And those non-economic choices are sometimes the ones that our grassroots members feel the most passionate about. Matt Heron, who's a civil rights era photographer who we work with, explained to me once that the reason he cares about copyright so much is not necessarily so much about the economic reasons, though that is a huge and important point for him, but because copyright allows him to make decisions which have allowed him to keep the photographs of the Selma to Montgomery march together, which he shot, and it ensures that the history of that period will be handed down to other generations in a whole and coherent fashion without images missing because they're controlled by somebody else, or without images having been devalued because they've been commercialized in ways that he disagrees with. And so finally, copyright is also about freedom. And we heard Jacqueline quote some Supreme Court cases to that effect, but it does play a core role in protecting our First Amendment rights of freedom of expression, and it also gives authors the freedom to create and thrive and create free from outside influence. The founders of the country were wise enough to see that the most important elements of any civilization include its independent creators and its authors, composers, and artists who create as a matter of personal initiative and spontaneous expression rather than as a result of patronage or subsidy. So what does all this mean more substantively? I mentioned that the overarching point that I hear every day from grassroots members is that in reviewing the Act, one must keep in mind both economic and non-economic ways that the Copyright Act encourages the creation and the dissemination of their works. For many creators, they won't be broadly disseminating their works unless they feel safe in doing so, both on economic and on non-economic grounds. And that's been demonstrated also with regard to non-professional creators, like users of Instagram, who, half of them abandoned the service last year when the site changed its terms of service in ways that suggested that photographs that were shared through that service could be commercialized without the photographer's blessing. And that's something that is not dissimilar to the views that musicians often express about whether it's an advertiser or a politician using their work to support a goal that the musician disagrees with. With regard to some very specific concerns, things that we've heard are worries about the operation of the DMCA notice and takedown provisions, particularly for independent artists who don't have the armies of lawyers and vendors who can scour the internet and send repeated notices to keep their works off of infringing sites. Concerns about how the registration system works, particularly for authors who are registering large volumes of works where each individual work might not have a known value or a large value at the time of registration. Photography is a very good example of that. Again, a photographer might take thousands of images on one weekend and it's not clear at the time of registration which one, if any of those images, will be a particularly valuable image, and if you fail to register, you are limiting your ability to enforce your copyright because so many of the remedies, in particular statutory damages, that a small independent creator would depend on are triggered by the registration requirement. Other linked issues to that is an interest in seeing the small claims process that the Copyright Office is looking into moved forward in some way. And finally, the expansion of voluntary agreements to include different types of creators and works, and to ensure that the agreements and the best practices that are developed by industry, working with industry, actually take into account individual artists and creators and are accessible and work for that community. So I'll conclude just by saying that we're urging Congress and the federal agencies to keep in mind how any change that they propose will affect the vast and the varied communities of creators that have to rely on the Copyright Act, to strive for a well-functioning Copyright Act that will unite the interests of all stakeholders to a common goal and not proceed from the basis of any one particular business model. To continue to afford themselves the opportunity to hear from a vast variety of creative people and market participants in order to understand how any changes that are being proposed will work for creative upstarts as well as for more established members of the creator and innovator community. And finally, to remember that there are multiple goals that the founders had in mind for copyright when the Constitution enshrined that right. I think for every argument for revision, we need to demand some specifics. After more than 200 years of copyright protection, we know that the basic premises of copyright protection work, and so we shouldn't risk those basic premises on vague or overbroad theories that are predicated on supporting the business goals of any particular industry. So the debates that we hear now are not so different from those that we've heard in the past. And the times and the players might be different, but the premises are the same, and the basic principles underlying the Copyright Act have withstood the test of time. Thanks. If anybody has a question, I'm happy to answer.
Hey, is this thing on? Wow.
Yeah.
Now it is. People watching the webcast can't see me. This is the voice of God. I know what you're thinking about copyright. If anyone has any questions for Sandra, we can probably take two, come up to either one of these microphones, and then we will introduce the next presenter.
Hi, my name is Thomas. You made a comment, you feel as though individual artists think that they're being taken out of the value chain. And what I see actually is a trend, or you said it was a trend. But what I see as the trend is that these organizations or the companies that are offering these services to get your music out there are allowing artists to opt in, and artists are just going willy-nilly into that, right? They're not really thinking about it, or they're just jumping into all these services. And I just wanted to make that point. I'm not sure that the trend is that they're, you know, as you were saying, I think it's a little more complicated. Does that make sense?
I hear your comments. What I was referring to is that the artists with whom I've spoken tend to express the view that it's easy for a big company to make a deal with another big company. It's easy for a big company to take advantage of artists who are perhaps not professional artists and their willingness to distribute their works without compensation using things like Creative Commons licensing. What's really difficult is dealing with the category of artists that really make up the bulk of the creative community, which are those middle-class artists that are working artists. And those people tend to get squeezed in discussions because they don't have the deep legal benches that a corporate copyright owner might have. They are, in fact, trying to make a living instead of just get recognition or accolades on the web that somebody, you know, relying on a purely non-commercial Creative Commons approach might have. And so the worry is that as you look at copyright review, that there will be pressure to make it easier to, you know, to license or use those works in the middle without really taking into account the interests of those individual artists, and that they'll get, you know, further squeezed out of whether it's compensation or the ability to kind of control how their work is disseminated and used.
Hi, my name's Natan. Just expanding on that, I think a lot of artists didn't like the old model either before the internet, where the majority of money for art in general was made by those who controlled avenues of distribution. And now that those avenues of distribution are breaking down, more people have access to distribution, which is sort of a double-edged sword for a lot of artists, because at first they get a lot of potential exposure, and then they might have trouble collecting on that exposure. But just like before, large businesses have the ability to make deals with each other. Even now, you know, the price of a Spotify stream being negotiated with large companies, et cetera. Large businesses also have the ability to negotiate with the government much easier. And the danger becomes possibly preserving old lines of distribution or limiting them, and therefore preventing a lot of artists without, unless they assign their rights like they used to have to and still do in a lot of cases, preventing them from getting any exposure or being able to engage in the business.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the intermediaries are still there. It's just perhaps a different category of intermediaries that artists are dealing with today. And I think there are views all across the spectrum as to whether people's fortunes have improved or stayed the same or gotten worse, given what their particular experience is. But clearly it's important for individual artists and creators to have a voice, both with large corporate interests, but with Congress in particular, as copyright laws are being reviewed, and that's why we're taking a very active role in following the debates in Congress, testifying to Congress, submitting testimony, and helping our grassroots members, submit letters that they want Congress to consider. And so I'm hopeful that that will give a voice to people who sometimes are left out of the debates entirely otherwise. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Sandra. One question I had, how can people get involved with the Copyright Alliance, or where do they go?
So you can go to our website, which is copyrightalliance.org.
That's copyrightalliance.org.
And there's actually a Take Action Now tab that you can click on, and you can also join our One Voice Activists Network there. We also have an app that distributes the latest copyright news and clips, as well as our statements and information we're getting from our artists.
Great. So for everybody on the live webcast who wasn't able to hear that, copyrightalliance.org will get you to a lot of relevant information. So I have a question for the audience. What's today? When's Halloween?
Thursday,
okay. Well, in preparation for Halloween, we have invited a very special guest whose name happens to be Count. And no, I am totally not making that up. That's what you call him, Count. He's probably heard this joke a bunch of times. And he's rolling his eyes at me right now. Count is a producer. He's got a long list of credits. He can tell you more about himself. He's also a filmmaker, and he's putting together a really interesting documentary that aims to reflect some musician experiences in this changing industry, some of the impacts of technology, good and less good. So Count, come on up and show us what you got. And why didn't you wear a cape?
That's it. All right, gooseneck. Okay, so I realize a lot of people here are knee-deep in the intricacies of copyright and intellectual property and policy. I am not going to pretend to be that. But what I have done is I've spent the past 2 years making this documentary, and we're in the process of editing it now, and I've put together a collection of some good clips from that, and what I'm going to do is show you that, and then talk a little bit about why I did this, and what this has led to an organization. So, without further ado, dim the lights, Casey's going to pour some wine for everybody, and we'll get cozy. Turn the music up.
Control isn't coming back.
The music industry's always been screwed up. It's extra screwed up now.
The digital delivery of intellectual property is our generation's nuclear power.
This technology is the most transformative thing of the entire past century.
We've got democratization. Anybody can be published. Anybody can have a record. Anyone can make a movie. But at the same time, the value of music and books and movies has been massively diminished. And it's harder than it's ever been to make a living as a creative person.
Any publisher of a book could have the same thing done to them.
This issue is not just a musician problem. It's impacting everything. Books, movies, software, photographs, journalism. The future for all creators is at stake.
Where do you draw the line? We're going to let people illegally download music, but it's, we won't let them illegally download motion pictures or television programs or software?
Look, the problem in a nutshell is that it's become voluntary to pay for music.
I think I'll volunteer to pay nothing.
We must protect the rights of the creator.
If something I create isn't my property, what is?
It's probably like the 1% can make a living out of it.
Napster sped the whole thing up.
Day one, Napster. It's like, boom, nobody buys music. Everyone's just gonna steal it forever.
When the tech world for the first time had to run into Hollywood, they didn't worry about what the rules were. There were no rules.
It was just denial and lawsuits.
The record labels should have made a deal. They rode their old business model down to the ground.
The entire public went from a perceived value of music as 16 bucks off this to zero. Like, overnight. Like, the perceived value of music is nothing.
And it left us all scratching our head, like, what do we do now? Do we go back to it just being a hobby? Do we find a day job?
Not like the music business was hard enough to begin with, man, damn.
I want to show you an antique that I brought with me. It's called a record.
Record producer? I didn't think they made those anymore.
You had everybody in the business going, well, you know, of course there'll always be Tower Records.
The part that they missed was that this was a strategic inflection point.
Suddenly the digital economy is upon us. What's the digital economy?
You want download services, you want subscription services, you want streaming services. Everything is available now.
All of that is being powered by the creativity of the musician. But where is the musician benefiting from this activity?
People seem to have convinced themselves that somehow magically everything can be free and everything will keep on going just fine. Free doesn't pay the rent.
Musicians have very simple goals. We want to make our music, and we want to make our music and have it support us.
99% of artists are not making a living at making music, if not more. They can't make a living. How do they make a living?
Under the new system, there is no middle class of artists anymore.
There's a band right outside my window, loading in to do an in-studio here. You know how much it costs to pay for that van? How much it costs to fill it up with gas? How much time they've taken? Where are they coming from? I don't know, Portland, Montana? They've been on the road all fucking day. They get here, they're gonna play in this radio station for free. They're gonna have to eat, they're gonna play. Maybe 100, 200 people show up if they're lucky. Then they have to cut that with the other band. Then they might sell 5 shirts, and then they're gonna get home, and guess what? They're gonna be just so pleased if they broke even. And all the while, that woman's gonna be listening to their music for free, sitting in her office and saying, oh, I'd go see him if I could.
You can't be a fan and then not support the band.
I'm especially concerned for independent artists.
Those are the people that have, like, lost out from all this piracy. It's not been some top executive, not at all. It's been the producers, the engineers, the sound techs.
These independent artists, these smaller voices, very, very much need some kind of intervention to help them. Society has to step in.
How are artists who make a living off of what they do, are they able to make a living anymore? When people just want to pay whatever they want.
What am I going to do when I get old, as we get older? What am I going to do for health insurance? What am I going to do if something goes wrong?
Oh, but you can just sell t-shirts, right?
Yeah, exactly. I can just get, I'll sell a few t-shirts and make up for it.
I'm a musician. I'm not a t-shirt maker. I'm not a designer. I wanted to sell music. I believe my music is worth something. The idea that musicians would only make a living through touring is kind of implying that they're not going to have families. They're not going to have lives.
What happens when an artist can't tour? Well, you know...
They're fucked.
They're fucked.
Look, for over a decade, people have been feasting on all this free stuff without any regard for how it's affecting the people making the things that we all love.
On the 20th of January, dozens of heavily armed police officers raided this house to arrest a man not accused of terrorism or murder, but internet piracy.
6:47 a.m., the 20th of January this year, and the raid is underway. Five of them also armed with semi-automatic weapons.
The law is protecting us.
Now we really have to do something.
Kim.com lives in a mansion, living the good life purely based on the backs of creators.
It's the Wild West, and just like in the Wild West there were robber barons that went and took what they wanted and pillaged, I believe that's what's happening today in the digital space.
You have to be able to pay creators for their genius, otherwise they're not going to spend their time developing their genius for the benefit of everybody else.
Intellectual property, the work of creators has a value. I think it's worth more than a donut. I think it's worth more than a latte.
The people creating it, they deserve something.
We need a world that guarantees artists have an opportunity to profit from their creativities.
That is conducive to both the fan and the artist.
I will say that a civilized society cannot long tolerate purely voluntary payment for art, knowledge, culture, innovation, information. This is the stuff of life. This is the stuff that makes our lives more worth living. And so if we allow them to fall to the status of a tip jar, we deprive ourselves.
Yeah, I don't know what's gonna happen, man. I really don't. I wish I had an answer, but I don't.
Thank you. Thank you, Jim Griffin. You had a lot of quotes in there, Jim. I didn't realize I relied so heavily on you. So, I was going to speak a lot, but after watching that, I don't know if I really need to say that much. Other than the fact that it's long overdue that we had this documentary, this public discussion about the realities of what independent artists are going through. Because for far too long, there's been this narrative of the myth of big Hollywood. Those artists are not big Hollywood. So what should we do? We have to debunk these myths. And I think a lot of people in this room know what those myths are, right? There's the myth of touring, the myth that artists make money on the road. Most artists lose money on the road. The myth of big Hollywood, right? These are not big Hollywood people. The myth of Kickstarter and selling t-shirts. I think Zoe's quote says it all. I'm an artist, I'm not a t-shirt maker. I believe my music is worth something. So, these myths, at the end of the day, are really just distractions from the real issue, which is the fact that recorded music has been devalued, but in general, the larger story is that, you know, the work of creators is at risk. And we can't afford to allow this new status quo to become the status quo, right? I think, you know, everyone that I interviewed, there was this absolute, you know, unanimity of the fact that everyone agreed that the old business sucked. The old model sucked. But it does, just because the old business sucks, it doesn't mean the new model should as well. And you often hear that a lot in conversations as a sort of as if it's some sort of an argument justifying why the new way should be terrible. But it's terrible in one way, right? It's great in so many ways. If you had a list of pros and cons, right, you could fill up the pros with like 100 amazing things about what's happening right now. There's no doubt that right now, it's never been better to be a creator, except for the whole making a living part. So, what can we do? Well, to me, I see three things converging at once that I somehow seem to have gotten involved in. I'm not sure how, but I'm a music producer for a living. So I took 2 years off of my career, a successful career, to make this unpaid because I feel that this is important, because people need to know. The people in this room probably do know, but I think the average person does not know. The second thing, I unfortunately can't talk about. So I'm kind of a big tease. But if it happens, or I should say, when it happens, it will be very big. Perhaps as big as Napster, certainly would change the industry. But I can't talk about it. So the third thing is that creators need a collective voice. For far too long, we've gone without a collective voice. And this brings me to the last thing that I'm going to mention, and then I'll shut up, which is the forming of a new organization called the Content Creators Coalition. So many of you in this room may have seen David Byrne's recent piece where he mentions the Content Creators Coalition. Perhaps a bit premature, but still great. I'm glad that he mentioned it. We are in the process of forming. So I'll just give you a little rundown. It's a very brief rundown of what we're doing. So recently, a group of dedicated artists, managers, and creators of all kinds decided it's time for us to have a collective voice. We decided to form a coalition that actually uses technology for our benefit and allows us to collectively voice our concerns in a way that can actually achieve results. Artists will no longer have to individually stick their necks out and publicly and risk being persecuted by the haters hiding behind their online anonymity. I should say the uninformed haters, because they usually are. Our agenda is really simple. It's that we have a right to a collective voice when it comes to how our works are used, monetized, exploited, and the policies that affect our livelihoods. And we want to help facilitate the conversation between artists and the music industry, the tech world, and most importantly, fans. And I think, hopefully, that's what this film will do. Because this film is not for the industry, it's for fans. But we aim to go further with the Content Creators Coalition, and that we can aggregate a collective voice of thousands of artists to make real change on some of the pressing issues that you see addressed in this film. We're not just musicians, although creative industries like movies, publishing, journalism are different in some ways. Now, ultimately, we are all in the same boat, which is that we are content creators. Content creators, the C word, I hate that word. But those are my smart ass air quotes. I know that this question will come up, so I'll just go ahead and say it now. The people behind this coalition are artists. This is 100% artists, run by artists, a diverse group of artists, for artists. We formed on our own initiative. There's no money behind us. We're all volunteers. We're currently finishing a web platform. And this platform essentially allows artists to sign in and learn about the issues affecting them, discuss these issues amongst themselves in a forum, and then actually allows us to vote as to whether we will take actions collectively. Artists can choose to be anonymous or public, which is very important because in the past decade, we've seen artists fearful. Artists that wanted to be in this film who couldn't because they were afraid, which makes absolutely no sense. This has to stop. So one way to do this is for us to just collectively voice these concerns, as opposed to as individuals risking the haters. the uninformed haters retaliating. So right now we're in the process of reaching out to artists and managers, and we're also bringing in people for our board of advisors, and as we are preparing for our launch in the coming months. So your help is welcome, whether you're a tech person who wants to help in the final stages of us finishing this platform, or if you're a legal expert or an industry expert, or just somebody interested in helping organize. At the moment, we have a splash page up, which allows you to sign up just to get more information. And that's the www.contentcreatorscoalition.org. That's the C word, contentcreatorscoalition.org. And that's, in a nutshell, all I need to say.
Are we doing questions or? We would go to questions, but Chatty McCount here kept on talking. Thanks, Count. So yeah, it's really great there's all this energy organizing around the artist community. You know, it makes me think of a certain organization that I know that's been around for 13 years that's been doing a lot of the work to organize creators and plug them into policy conversations. So the more the merrier, and I think that film looks really great. Our next speaker is, he has literally played on every single record I like. I think with the exception of Rain and Blood, but he may be uncredited. So I would like to welcome to the stage Melvin Gibbs, who's going to make everything okay for us. Come on up, Melvin.
Hello, I'm Melvin Gibbs. And I'll just run down a little bit of what I've done to create some context for what I'm about to say. I've been a professional musician since 1980, touring. I started off in a scene in New York City called the No Wave scene. And as a kid, I was kind of what they used to call in the old days a toy graffiti artist, which means I was not very prolific. But I was a lot of friends with a lot of guys who were in that community. One of whom became extremely famous as a regular artist, Jean-Michel Basquiat. And I work with different, as well as working with different sort of punk-ish groups. I also was worked a lot in the jazz scene and the various different underground music scenes in New York in the 80s. As time went on, I kind of moved up the food chain in the jazz world, but it got to a certain point where I realized, hey, man, I'm a kid. I should be doing some younger music. So I switched over to doing rock and roll. So in the 90s, I had a band called I&I that had a very short-lived record deal with Sony, but I got to get the major label experience as opposed to the underground music experience I had before. And then after that, I joined the Rollins Band, and I spent 5 years in that band. Got nominated for a Grammy in 95. And after that, ran its course. I kind of got more involved in the world music area, spent a lot of time down in Brazil working with people there. And as I got older, I realized, okay, now it's time for me to, now that I'm like an adult, I'll play some adult music and I'll move back into the jazz world. And I've just come back from a tour with a project called Black Sun, which is a collaboration with a group that I'm a member of called Harriet Tubman. And the singer Cassandra Wilson, who ironically enough was won Grammys the year that I got nominated for that. It's a weird synchronization there. And the last show we did on the tour was in Belgrade, Serbia. And the show was actually sponsored by the US Embassy as part of the Belgrade Jazz Festival. And it's always interesting that jazz music has such a connection with the US government. I mean, Dizzy Gillespie toured for the government. There are many different artists touring right now, jazz touring for the government. And one of the reasons of that is because, first of all, it was developed in the US by people of African descent who created a culture and a way of thinking that reflected democracy, jazz, everybody has a voice. It's free, you can do what you want to do within the parameters of the music. And so it's a great expression of what's best about the US in a certain way. You have collaboration, you have meritocracy, only the best musicians get to get on stage. And it's made by individuals coming together in small groups, which becomes problematic in the context of the way things are moving in society, because it's not about corporate interests. And one serious thing is that it doesn't scale. There's only one Miles Davis, there's only one John Coltrane, there's only one Cassandra Wilson. So it is the antithesis of what works on the internet, because you can't aggregate or crowdsource your way towards good jazz. It just won't work. So because of that, it's in danger now. It's in danger in the age of aggregation, in the age of bundling and unbundling. What's getting bundled and unbundled are the things that have, that aren't vital to creating and disseminating the music. They're vital to creating and disseminating technology. So, as you saw in the movie, that actually covered a lot of what I was going to say, which is great, so now I get to say a bunch of other things I didn't think I was going to have time to say. There are 41% less professional musicians in New York City, in the United States than there were, 41%. Now, you can say that the music business as it existed for in a vast majority was not in the interest of musicians, but it's been 14 years since Napster. The new business model is not in the interest of musicians. The original iTunes deal did not even negotiate a mechanical royalty. They were not even thinking about paying the artists. So the question becomes, instead of stomping your feet and whining about it, what should happen? And the CCC is an interesting direction to take with that, because I think it's a question of thinking about the artists in an aggregate, as opposed to artists as a bunch of individuals that are just little pieces of content, because then they can just be picked off and arranged any way you feel like it. And I think it'd be interesting, actually, to think of the collective of musicians as a channel on their own that is being pushed through this pipeline. Now, as individual musicians, they're not making any money, but as something that's flowing through a pipeline, the pipeline itself is generating an amazing amount of money. So on one level, it's not true to say that music isn't making money. It is true to say that most people get it for free. So the question going forward is, how do you square that circle between the fact that this music is generating a ridiculous amount of money, but none of it is flowing to the people who are actually creating it? I would say that a good analogy would be thinking as I said earlier, the aggregate of creators as their own channel, and create a system that monetizes that channel and interfaces that channel with the other channels, as opposed to Spotify, which becomes the channel. Because one of the things, not to pick on Spotify, because you know I'm not here to pick on anybody, but one of the things that kind of, in a nutshell, tells the story is that the reason Spotify doesn't want to pay a reasonable rate is because they can't justify their business model by paying a good rate. But we cannot. Musicians don't exist to justify somebody else's business model. How do we justify our own business model? How do we get to a situation where we can represent America around the world as a force of democracy if we can't even pay for strings for our instrument? So something I want you to think about. Thanks for your time. Yeah, I'll do a couple of questions if anybody wants to ask.
Hi. Sort of a statement. I mentioned earlier that people tend to look at their industry without looking at the others. I tend to quarterback in terms of what I do, and I've been addressing copyrights with Congress. And I chose to do it starting from the one person up, where I will write an article and I will drop it on the legislators whose staffs I've met with. And I have impacted a difference where they're now asking about the artists and photographers. Point is, most people don't know how Congress works. And it's really simple. There's a lot of people that come and are paid to speak for us. I went to Congress because of my royalties. And there is a power, but it's not just Congress. The ears that they're hearing from, or the mouth, are from the tech companies, who have models that are so expansive, most people don't know about them. So I've chosen to go directly after the tech companies and what they violate, which is fair use and safe harbor. So while we're coming up with more and more coalitions, we're duplicating process. We need to come together instead of expanding to more coalitions, to less. Fair use, we have the ladies here. It's simple. Title 17, Section 107, 4 points. Number four, the one people don't look at, says if you prevent the artist from making a living, it's not fair use. Number three says if you use their item so it's identified or taken from it, it's not fair use. We're being bled by people that claim education. So we need to know our laws. I think we need to streamline our groups, and that Unsound movie is awesome. I want you to expand it beyond musicians to include the writers, the authors that have the same voice as I hear here. So that was awesome.
All right, well, I don't really need to add anything to that. I will add a couple of things. The musicians were first. So it doesn't mean that everybody, you know, I mean, we're spearheading this because we've kind of been through it already. It's not because that it's not a problem for any. Basically, it's a problem for any person, anybody who can be content. So yes, we all need. And the second thing is that I think, in fact, there may need to be different organizations because people aren't going to agree on how to move forward. But I think what also should happen is that the different organizations should network and find places where the few things that they all agree on so there can be a nice hammer going forward.
You are absolutely correct. Musicians are first. You're the ones that everybody look at and say, why didn't we do it? So you have to give yourself a pat on the back for that, too.
Okay. This is a little bit more of a statement rather than a question, and I want to address it to you because if it's going to be a brief statement, then I'll just wait for the next person because it's a little bit lengthy. Okay, all right, sorry, I'll make this quick. So you have experience with No Wave, which is, you know, sort of an unorthodox musical genre for its time. It's sort of a counterculture movement. That's not a value statement. But I'm curious to get your perspective on this, because for me personally, all the major albums that I've bought in the last 2 years that haven't been from artists I've followed, I've bought them because they were leaked onto the internet. And, you know, it was because I was able to access them through this much more public distribution method rather than have them sort of being sold to me. You know, in that documentary, they showed an image of the sleeve for Radiohead's album Kid A. That's an album that leaked a month before it was released. It debuted at number one, and Radiohead has cited that the leak was responsible for that, or at least played a big part in generating the publicity and the word of mouth for this album. I work at a record company that has been hit hard by these sort of new distribution changes. I'm a pessimist. I don't really like the way the industry is going. I understand all these perspectives, but I do think there is something to be said for these sort of rights infringements and the publicity they can generate, and that you know, that relies on the sentimentality of physical goods and people still wanting to buy the album after they've downloaded it illegally. And that may not be the majority opinion, but I feel like it is a valid point to bring up.
Well, I'll answer that fairly quickly. As I was saying earlier, if we think of the aggregate of people who create stuff as their own channel, that channel should be paid. So if you have a situation where you have this channel flowing through a cable television line or a telephone line, that channel should be monetized. So it really doesn't matter if the people get the thing for free or not, because they're not actually getting for free. You're paying your cable bill. You're paying your phone bill. So that's, in my opinion, where the money should come from.
Can I just say that I love the internet? I'm going to say it for the record right now. I love the damn thing. Our next speaker likes the internet just okay as well. He's been around in this industry for a very, very long time. And, you know, stop me if you've heard this one before, but one of the pinch me moments I've had at Future Music Coalition was getting a phone call, picking up the phone and hearing, "Casey, it's Peter Jenner." And, you know, that's a voice ringing in my ear of the original manager of Pink Floyd. He's done amazing other things. He's here today to tell us a little bit about the international perspective, because remember, we spend a lot of time on U.S. copyright law, but the internet is global. So, Peter, come on up and drop some science.
Where to start? What to say? Do I have any notes? Yes. Have I worked out what to say? No. So I will just say some things, partly tricked off by what I've heard. Let me say first of all that I've been in the destroying artists' careers for 45 years, and I have to tell you that they've been mainly unsuccessful. They're the occasional successful artist, but most of them have been unsuccessful and have gone off to do other things. And that's been the case forever. And I think we should be mindful of that. And also in my years as a manager and all the other stuff I've done, most artists think that what they're doing is fantastic and unbelievable, and why the hell don't people give them a lot of money? And I have to say that in my experience, most artists are just more of the same. And I think we should be realistic about that. There is exceptional artists, and there are artists who are expressing themselves and having a good time, and good luck to them. And there are artists who are exceptional and we wish to pay to go and see them, to buy their records or to whatever, or to relate to them in some way. This, I think, is an important point. If you have a following, whatever the technology, you can make a living somehow, somewhere, with someone, somehow. The ways you do it now are different from what they were 45 years ago, but they're still there. And we have to think about how we deal with it. Being rather old, I also have a historical view of things. And I think we have to look at what we did in Europe as to how we get paid for radio in Europe. We have two collection societies in the UK, essentially, called PPL and PRS. PPL collects for the recordings and PRS collects for the underlying works. Historically, these were also all over Europe, and there was a beginnings of a system, albeit very imperfect. But it was a way in which radio could pay for the music that they used. In the US, you have developed the splendid sound exchange, which we don't have. Sound exchange, a lot of bitching and moaning, I'm sure. But let me tell you, it's collecting from a lot of people and making it easy for people to pay. That is the key. We have to make it easy for people to pay. It probably also requires that people shouldn't always be aware of the fact that they're paying. You know, when you watch TV, it's free. No, it's not. You're paying for it. you're paying for your cable, perhaps, or you're just paying through the goods that you buy in the shop for the absurd adverts you have to put up with. You're paying for the absurd political adverts that you have to put up with, because someone somewhere is making money which is paying for those things. Nothing is free, or very little is. I don't know, have they got a meter on the air yet? But they're working on it. So anyway, so in all that context, let me say that I think that the other thing which has come to me from what we've been talking about today so far is that artists have to aggregate. They have to work together. The interesting thing is the Creators Content Creators Coalition. What's not interesting is no mention of the AF of M, no mention of AFTRA, no mention of the Music Managers Forum, no mention of the Future of Music Coalition. I mean, for God's sake, how many organizations do we have to do which say the same thing, which is, for God's sake, pay us? And I think that is the clear message. There is a huge amounts of money, which was coming in the last presentation, there's huge amounts of money going through the net. All we've got to do is to put up our hands and say we want our fair share. Historically, that fair share has been snagged. One hand, you have the creators. On the other hand, you have the end users. In between those people have been, when in the old days with records, there were record companies, there were publishers, there were retailers, there were wholesalers, there were distributors, there were manufacturers, there were managers, there were agents, there were unions. All these people taking a bite. What's changed? Let's try and see if we can cut down some of those people so that the money flows more easily from the end users who are paying for their their network connections, who are paying for their devices. How can we find some money flowing from them to the creators? And it won't be to all the creators. It will go to the popular creators. It will go to bloody Justin Bieber. It'll go to Lady Gaga. Do I like that? No, but that's the price I have to pay for some money going to Billy Bragg. And that's what we have to realize. We can't say, well, my stuff is more valuable than your stuff. We have to say that all content in some way is equal. We can't make decisions as to what's got value. You as an individual can. You can sign up to special services, and maybe artists can have their special services. Maybe we need to have lots of different ways of accessing music online. Maybe we've got to make it easy for lots of new services to develop which do access music. What's a scandal about Spotify is that it's the only one. That's the scandal. The scandal of Spotify is that we don't know what the deal is. That's the scandal. Where's the money coming from? Where's going to? Why am I getting so little? That's the issue. And I think if the artists and the creators and the writers and all the people who are involved in making the music got their shit together and worked together and stopped being so effing precious about what my art and all that stuff, we'd all be in a better position. Let me also say that anyone who thinks that we can control the internet is up their ass, you know. Basically, it is uncontrollable. All we can hope to do is to get paid. And I think we can hope to get paid. We have to work on getting paid. And we have to work together on getting paid in the same way that they worked out in the end how you could pay to get a song put onto a recording. There was a system. And it's probably, dare I say it, collective. It might involve unions. It might involve all sorts of things which are not strictly individualistic and free enterprise. And I recommend that. I recommend that we think about collective action in order to get people paid sensibly. I think that'll do. I've had enough, I think. See you later.
Peter Jenner doesn't want your stinking questions. So our next speaker, we're just, we can't say enough about her. She's our hero. She really cares about all this stuff. She's super smart. She walks it like she talks it. That's all I'm going to tell you about Erin McKeown.
You got something here?
Yeah, it's in the preview. It's minimized in preview.
Preview, here you go.
Yeah. Add a to it. Thanks.
Hey, Peter, that was some good bullshit. That was a reference to our conversation at dinner last night, but that was fantastic. Thank you.
Let me just get this up on a full screen.
Okay. I'm Erin McKeown. Casey said so lovely. I love Future Music Coalition. I'm really happy to be here. I think this is the fifth time I've been to this conference. I'm a musician, writer, and producer. My 10th album came out this year. I've been a professional musician since 1995, which was high school for me. And I think in thinking about what I wanted to say to you today, I have spent plenty of time in the weeds talking about legislation and talking about copyright and things like that, real close to it and real specific. But I've also spent the last 6 months working on a big project that has pushed some of this work to the side for me, and I really have been being almost a full-time artist for the last 6 months for the first time in a long time. And so I'm coming back to this with a kind of different shaded perspective, and my head is spinning a little bit, to be honest. And this is not to say that musicians should not be educated, should not know the weeds, should not know all this stuff, but I'm just saying I'm coming back to it today with a different perspective than the last few years when I've been working more closely on this. So when Casey asked me to do this, I sort of decided to put this together from that perspective, from sort of a 10,000 foot perspective. But if you want to talk to me about specific policy things, let's network. But I want to go way up in the air for this. And I have baseball in my mind, so we're going to start with this picture here. And what I'm going to do is read to you an essay that I have adapted for today. But it's an essay that I wrote for a book that came out this year called The 360 Deal. It was written by a guy named Andrew Dubber, and I'll give you the link at the end of the presentation. But it's 360 music professionals giving 360 words of advice to people in the music industry. So this will be more than 360 words, but this is where it comes from. And then I've sort of reconfigured it for today. So you want to be in the music business? So you want to stay in the music business, really? Okay, I'm going to ask you again. So you want to be in the music business? You want to stay in the music business, really? Okay, I'm going to ask twice because I want you to be sure. Here is what I know. Be extraordinary. Learn to play your instrument at an extraordinary level. Find the time, find the teacher, be very, very good at what is in your hands or coming out of your mouth. Own your own land, do not sharecrop. Learn to write your own songs. You must own your own land. Do not sharecrop and expect to be treated fairly. Learn what kind of responsibilities go with your land, and don't sell unless the price is very, very high. Parcel your day and cultivate your switch. Learn to parcel your day, an hour for business, an hour for practice, an hour for writing. Cultivate the switch in you that allows you to be an artist or a business person, but not both at once. Make community, ask for help, and give help. Learn to connect and privilege that connection above all. Teach, show, tell. Learn to support your peers and let them support you. Give all due credit and pay what something costs. Learn that it matters who made what when. When the provenance of a song is rich, it becomes even more precious when money is scarce. Learn to pay a fair wage, learn to ask for a fair wage. Learn to be open. Share what you have, say what you mean, and mean what you say. If you see something, say something. Learn to fight, expose, agitate. If you don't like how things are, don't let them stay that way. This gives you purpose, this builds community, this makes change. Failure is a spiritual experience. Popularity is not. Learn that you will fail sometimes. Learn that you will not be popular and you will not know why. Learn that you will be popular and you will not know why. And learn that it will all go away again anyway, no matter what you do or don't do. You are not your career. So you should learn about something besides music and the music business. Learn a language, learn to paint, learn to landscape, learn to sweat, find love. And finally, look up. Learn that there is a power greater than you, a tree, the wind, the universe, God, whatever it is, so long as you know that it is not you. Work on this spiritual practice every day because you will need to ask it for the strength to carry on in the shit show that is the music industry. Oh, and by the way, love music. Thank you.
I think we have a question from the internet. If I can find it, somebody emailed it to me. You guys know that technology, right? The email? In the meantime, if anyone in the audience wants to come down, we got time for two. And please, we don't need your high school or grad school thesis. Just a question.
I have a question. Hi, I'm a mother of two young musicians, and my husband and I are not musical at all. And I'm wondering where the voice of really young musicians is. You mentioned high school. They're even younger than that. I just think about all the complex questions we're hearing about and the time it takes to figure this all out. And I think about that generation and the generation even behind my young boys.
So your question is...
We're talking about aggregating. I think about kids. Is there anyone leading up a group? And when kids talk, people really listen. So I'm just curious, and I'd be glad to get involved. I'm sure my boys would. I just think that you look in the room, and I know they're all in school, but where that aggregate is.
Well, I think it's like anything having to do with kids. It comes from a lot of different places. I know I can only say what was missing for me as a kid that I would have wished and would wish for other kids. I've done a lot of work with the girls' rock camps. I think those are a great way. I know that the one that I've taught at for years always includes a music business part of it, always includes a really great section called For Mothers that talks about women that came before you. I mean, that was part of what I was saying here, is that the history of a song is really important, and then we might show that value and importance with money, but the history is important. So I think community and history, and some of that coming from camps and some of that coming from families, I think is really important. I mean, I think you as a parent get to talk about this. I mean, mostly when I think about the younger generation and I think about the students that I work with and the young people that I work with, in some ways it's about a habit. It's just about showing them, oh, there's a different way to consume music, there's a different way to think about music. And I think the more of them that actually make music, which is a larger discussion about music education in our communities, but the more of them that actually make music, I think some of this stuff becomes more obvious. The tactile experience of making music, I think, rather than the sort of mediated experience of grabbing it off the internet.
Can we write a song and record it together, Erin?
Yes, please, Raul.
All right, cool.
Thanks, everybody. By the way, I need a manager.
So we have a question from the internet. Erin doesn't have to answer it. The question is, after hearing all this depressing stuff and the need for new organizations, why aren't we talking about Future of Music Coalition's contribution to Sound Exchange, the fastest growing part of the music business, where the artists get 50%? Well, we don't contribute to Sound Exchanges and give them money, but we do support the license that pays musicians half if they're signed and pays them directly, simultaneously with labels. And we also support the webcasters who utilize that license because You know, this is a really important part of the marketplace. So hopefully that answers your question. Coming up next, we have a fella that I only recently just met, but he's impressed me so incredibly much, Jeremy Peters from Ghostly Records. He's one of, I say this, you know, with absolute conviction, he's one of the smartest, brightest, most with it younger people in the music industry, and he really should give all the old duffs like you, Peter, a lot of hope for the future.
I don't know if I agree with Casey's characterization of me, but... So hello, my name is Jeremy Peters, and I've worked at Ghostly International and Ghostly Songs as its Director of Creative Licensing and Business Affairs for the past decade or so. Since I license songs to television commercials, video games, and manage intellectual properties for about 40 electronic and indie rock artists, I wanted to point out a few things that I've noticed along the way, and perhaps make some suggestions on what modernizations to copyright here, at least in the U.S., would... benefit maybe just our artists, but hopefully artists in general. Everyone and their mother seems to be saying that copyright is broken, but other than the folks at the Creative Commons, and I'm making a large generalization here, we don't hear much in the way of solutions, at least in a cohesive sense, of how to fix it. And at least not in a sense that considers the interests of all the parties involved. Some of this is because the process is such a bear. And the second you open that can of worms, per se, it seems like the infighting begins. Creators are sad because they feel their rights keep getting infringed. Companies look for less stringent rules as we all move from a culture of ownership to a culture of rental, search, and discovery. And disruptors or reinventors, be they creatives or technologists, who look to make commentary on or change what has been done in the past, are sidelined by overwhelming restrictions on the work that they do. It isn't about folks brazenly stealing, and it isn't about big corporations trying to punish the little man. We fall into these overplayed and underwhelming caricatures every time a change to copyright law is proposed, however. That, my friends, needs to stop. It is massively unproductive, and we all know it. Arguing about it without being willing to compromise, saying copyright needs to end, or you are all criminals, reminds me of a little argument that happened a few blocks from here that shut our country down for over 2 weeks. Was that productive? I bet most of us would say no. What I'm interested in is trying to make the process of remixing and mixing easier, to ensure that that next DJ Shadow or brilliant mashup artist gets a fair shake and doesn't have to worry about the law coming after him for selling a copy of his brand new mix to friends that have been begging him or her for it. To ensure that the MC who's just getting his name out isn't attacked by someone for using a beat that wasn't approved on a mixtape. I'm a musician at heart. I studied music at the University of Michigan, studied voice. And so I care more about the music itself. But I know from my job and the decade of experience that I have at a smaller scale record label and music publisher that the royalties each artist makes are the key to them making new work. When I say record label, and music publisher, you have to trust me. We're not in any way the image that comes to mind when most folks think of those things. We have small budgets, a small staff, and fight hard to collect royalties for the songwriters that we work with and the recording artists we release. Unfortunately, the name mention of the names music publisher or record label in the post-Napster world can seem like dirty words. There are those who swear never to be involved with them, not even necessarily knowing what we do. Folks who judge before realizing that there are a multitude of kinds of music businesses, and conversely, artists who've been burned so badly by those miscreants in the business that they have every right to go out on their own. All the above is fine. My worry is, however, that the wholesale statement that music publishing or record labels are evil does no good for anyone. We look at ourselves, at least, as investors in creative content. That ambient record we knew would only sell 500 copies that we were able to put in a car commercial, and by the way, that the artist was thrilled with. The artists who have retirement accounts and down payments for houses because we were able to put a spotlight on their music. And those able to focus on creating because we provided them a stream of income that can buy new gear and have removed the worry of having to make physical products off of their minds. With all that being said, I'm here to talk about a few ideas that I think might be able to get us on the track moving forward. I'm not saying that this is the be-all, end-all solution to what ails us, but perhaps, just maybe, it's a starting or jumping off point for a discussion that we all know, even those who might campaign against it, needs to happen. Snowcap was, whatever you believe, ahead of their time. And I think they might have been on an appropriate path, at least in terms of methodology. I hope some of the ideas that they had in a general sense, at least in terms of methodology, maybe can be codified into law. So what do I think we should do? One, perhaps make a little fix to mechanical copyright law. And mind you, I'm saying this as a music publisher. The system of compensating songwriters for their compositions. I think that the royalty rate is paid is arguably fair, and I'll leave arguments about that for others to hash out. I'm more interested in the methodology again. I propose we get rid of the minimum fee and work on the basis of the actual time a piece of music is used in a piece. In this way, the fraction of a minute or second, for that matter, of a single drum hit or a phrase in that person's composition is used in a new composition could be paid for mathematically. Simple for the creator, simple for the remixer, simple for the mashup artist, and the reuser to know, and simple from a business standpoint, very easy to pay. Two, work out a nearly similar methodology for sampling master recordings into new works, and I realize I might get some tomatoes thrown at me for that. The process of licensing a cover, at least these days, and the paying of the appropriate mechanical in this country is fairly simple. Why then isn't there a methodology that applies to the embodiment of that composition into the master recording? I'm not proposing a rate here again, but I think that the methodology that can both fairly compensate the original master artists and not prevent creators from reinterpreting works into new pieces is maybe where we need to go. I say this from specific examples for us, and I know of multitudes of other examples where more modern style DJs, hip hop artists, remixers, mashup artists have come into these same situations. And we don't want to prevent creativity. We need to figure out a way to embrace it while we're still paying appropriately for content. Hopefully, the era of unlicensed samples to a certain degree and million-dollar infringement suits would arguably cease to exist. And thirdly, maybe take a second and heed some of the legal structures, at least, that the Creative Commons Coalition has built and codify those licenses and methods for both commercial and non-commercial licensing of copyright into law. By making them widely known, simple, and easy to use, not that they aren't already, we solve multitudes of problems in the world of infringement. You then have a regulatory structure that is now understood by labels easily, publishers easily, lawyers easily, and most importantly, musicians easily, and the courts, rather than a set of legal arguments that work well for many, but often contradict what regulatory law states about the nature of copyright. This would help clarify what music is perfectly fine to use in that YouTube video or your company's promotional video, and clarify a process to get a license if you don't immediately have rights, which is, at least from my experience, licensing music to videos and to commercials, a huge concern. So those are only three examples, but I hope three powerful ones, I hope. And I know that I'm not the first person to say any of this, but I hope it does make a point that I'm someone from within the label and publisher community that is advocating for modernization. Why? I firmly believe it wouldn't harm the amount of money that we can make for our artists, and would immensely help many of them express their creativity fuller. Reinterpretation and borrowing has been around forever, from the medieval period on down. And in the opinion of this industry veteran, it's time to finally take a step forward and pay attention to that fact in the law, without leaving those original creators hanging out to dry for creating such brilliant and inspiring source material.
Super short on time, so we probably won't do a question because we want to hear from our next presenter. And our next presenter is an amazing fella. He's got a huge heart. He wrote one of the greatest rock songs in the canon, Hit Me with Your Best Shot. He is the president of the Songwriters Guild or Association? Assocation of Canada, and his name is Eddie Schwartz, and he's going to come up here and talk to you now.
Hi, everybody. We'll be right with you. Ah. How do you like my presentation so far? Thank you. By the way, I've decided to change my name to Sad Eddie as of today. If I start to actually weep during this presentation, please forgive me in advance. There we go. Okay. Thank you. It's certainly an honor to be amongst this group of wonderful presenters today, and some of, if not a lot of, what I'm going to go over has already been expressed, but although I am sad, Eddie, I'm also hopeful, Eddie, and we'll get to that a little later as I go through the slides, so it may not be quite as depressing as it first sounds. Obviously, the future of music creators is important to me because that's what I've been doing for a living for a long time. Some 200 artists over the last, I don't even want to talk about how many years have done my songs, including, of course, Pat Benatar and Joe Cocker, the Doobie Brothers, Rascal Flatts more recently, and many others. So I have to say, to use a phrase that I heard not long ago in Nashville from a country writer, I'm a very lucky guy. I've got some hay in the barn, was the expression he used, which I thought was quite charming. So what I'm about to propose is really not for my generation. I've experienced both the old model and the new model. As somebody said in the movie, it was terribly difficult then, and it's even harder now. So, but anyways, let me walk you through this, and maybe there'll be some interesting information here. So we know we've talked about a number of new models today. People have mentioned Spotify, and I will get to some very interesting, I hope interesting information about Spotify in a minute. But these models are, for the first time, legitimate, paid, authorized services are getting some traction. Pandora is another one we hear about. And I think it's important to say this. As somebody who has created music all these years, and I don't know that any music creator would disagree with this, I want people to enjoy my work. I embrace these models in the sense that I'm thrilled that there are good ways, efficient ways, easy ways for people to enjoy my music. So I don't want anything that comes after this to be interpreted as some kind of railing against the technology. And again, that's been mentioned, but I want to just reinforce that. I have no problem with the technology or the internet. I agree with Casey. I love the internet. So that this is not an old fogey railing against technology. However, and we've seen some case studies. Gene earlier in the day went through a few things, shared some information. This is going to be a very brief case study of one person. Now, that is an actual statement received from a music publisher by a young but quite successful songwriter whose name will remain unmentioned. This statement was received just a few weeks ago. It's the period ending June 2013, which is the way these things are typically are distributed 90 days, 60 to 90 days after the period ends, you get a statement. So you can see it's all Spotify USA. It's Streaming Mechanicals. And we'll just go into, this is one page of a statement that was quite a few pages. And this is, to explain to you what's going on here, you can see the leftmost numbers are the amount of streams. I'm just zeroed in so we could look at this. You can see it's 100% of revenue. And then you can see, 5 minutes, I just got up here for crying out loud. And you can see some of the revenue sources on the right side. For example, there's 118,719 streams. And if you follow that across, you can see that that earned 65 cents. So let's do some arithmetic. People have talked about the old model, the new model, what the difference is, how much people are making. this is some pretty, this is the nitty gritty. You're actually seeing a statement from that a songwriter gets. So on that particular page, I added up all the streams in that column you saw on the right, and it comes to 162,525 streams. That's pretty good. That's a lot of people listening to your music. I would call that a pretty successful page. Total revenue, US, $11.46. Now, this particular writer has a 50-50 deal with their publisher. So they get to take home $5.73. So what's interesting is these new legitimate services are we're trying to port people over from piracy, right, which pays that amount. I don't know what kind of idiot would put all those numbers to say zero. But here's why that kind of idiot did that. That's what Spotify pays. So you have to go to the songwriter. So you have to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 digits to the right of the decimal point before there's a difference between piracy, which we've been fighting supposedly for the last 15 years, so we can port people over to legitimate services. Five digits to the right of the decimal point before you get a number that actually means something, and that number is a 3. And the next number is a 5, so I guess that's better. But just so everyone understands how, I'll use the word ludicrous, this can be, many of the intermediaries that distribute monies to songwriters round that number down. You'll never guess what they round it down to. 0. So in effect, there is no difference between piracy and legitimate authorized streaming services at this point, as far as many creators are concerned. So we're going to extrapolate just for a few minutes so we really get the sense of this. So the good news is, if you have 1 million streams, you can order the pizza and the wings. I think that's significant. Now, let's look at the old model, because again, as I said, my career in some ways fortunately has spanned both models. In the old days, and by the way, there are still physical sales. They're down considerably, and downloads do pay the mechanical rate of old iTunes. So the writer's share in that case would be something like $45,000. But I want you to keep in mind that that was called a platinum record. A gold record, to remind ourselves, was 50,000 copies. So it would have been half that. And this is, of course, if there's only one writer, by the way, many songs written by 2 or 3 people. So this is 100% of what the writer's share would be, which, as I said, may have been shared by more than one person. So platinum records in the heyday were, as Peter pointed out, not a common thing at all. They came by very rarely in a career, and the writer's 100% writer share would be something like $45,000 US. So still not a lot of money, and someone could have been writing songs for 10 years before they had that kind of success. So still not a lot of money. I don't know if I'd use the word fair for that. I don't know what I would call that. At any rate, so let's move away from this little case study and talk about the value chain, which has been mentioned. So others in the value chain, CEOs, investors, shareholders extract millions of dollars from these businesses. And internet service providers, telecommunication companies, and global conglomerates facilitate access to the world's repertoire of music and receive immense financial reward for doing so. So it's not like there isn't a value chain that is definitely serving the purposes of many other interests beside the music creators. And that's easily ascertained. So music creators believe it's time for a new narrative and a system that places their work at an appropriate level in the value chain. And this is one of the ideas, and you've heard some other ones, but this is where I think things start to get a little more hopeful. This is an initiative that a number of us are working on right now. And the number is about 25,000. So there are about 25,000 music creators from many countries now working together to adopt fair trade music principles and to work to develop certification criteria. So who are these people? Peter rightly pointed out that There are a lot of different organizations. We need to work together. So these are the organizations that have banded together internationally to work on this idea of fair trade music. Before I go through them, I should say that the people have said this is a global problem, I think. That's a very, very important point I'd like to reinforce. SOPA was not a good experience for those of us who got involved in it. 5 years or more of work was destroyed by 5 days of interests that that were antithetical to that legislation. So it's very clear that I think to a lot of us, number one, that how important, and I don't want to diminish the importance of the U.S. Congress, but at the same time, I think at this point in the game, whatever it is now, 15 years in, for us to put all of our eggs in the U.S. Congress basket into political process, I think is a very, very foolish thing to do. I mean, it may work for us. Copyright reform may happen in 5 years or 10 years, and it may be we may have a better world because of it. But I think it's very important that music creators take, to whatever degree they can, this matter into their own hands and not rely on another copyright bill. Spend the next 5 years working on it for somebody to come along and in the last 5 days knock it off. So, anyway, so the groups that are involved with this now are CSAM, which is the Composers and Songwriters International Council. They're affiliated with CSAC. I don't know if you guys know that. That's the umbrella group for the performing rights societies around the world in Europe. EXA, the European Composer and Songwriter Association. PAXA, the Pan-African Group. ALCAM is Latin and South America. And the group that I have the honor to co-chair with Rick Carnes of the Songwriters Guild of America, Music Creators North America. So these are the people who are now working on this. So what we're trying to do is develop fair trade music certification criteria. And we're working with those, with a group of experts, and I'll get into that in a second, to develop criteria that are supportable and fair to consumers, creators, and businesses. So the idea of fair trade coffee, if we go back to that for a second, because obviously we're building on that idea, is that you certify businesses to make sure that the people who actually grew the coffee were participating in a fair way in the value chain. Up until that time, third world coffee growers were clearly not. And so the system of fair trade coffee, and there are other agricultural products as well, was developed so that the people who created the essential element in the value chain, the coffee, were fairly compensated for that role that they played, that essential role. And that's basically the idea behind this. But you have to develop criteria for this particular question, fair compensation. What is fair compensation? I mean, it's a great term, sounds great, but what does it mean? What does it really mean? So here's the overriding principle that we're working from. Fair compensation, music business models must be built on principles of fair and sustainable compensation for music creators. And there's another aspect to fair compensation, fair compensation cannot stand alone without this, transparency. International standards must be developed and adopted that ensure efficient and transparent management of revenues derived from the use of our works. These standards would apply to all entities that collect and distribute such revenues. So we're not just talking about the Spotify's or the Pandora's of the world, we're talking about all the intermediaries. We're talking about record labels, we're talking about music publishers, we're talking about performing rights societies. Why shouldn't there be standards to look at all of these, every hand that the money that creators' works generate? Why shouldn't everyone in the value chain have to fairly compensate and be transparent when it comes to handling music creators' monies? So again, as I said, this is one of the challenges we're dealing with now. And I'm going to go through these very quickly because I imagine we're probably running a little late at this point. But is it a percentage of gross revenue? That's what traditional terrestrial radio pays. Is it an equity stake like venture capitalist CEOs and labels receive? Remember, interestingly enough, I don't know if this has been mentioned today, the major record labels own a piece of Spotify, which I think in itself is an interesting fact that hasn't been brought forward. So we're working on that. That's to be determined. On transparency, creators rarely know the following. Gross revenue at source. So most of us have deals with publishers or record labels that say we get 50%. People have more, they have less, but let's just say 50%. 50% of what? Well, most of those deals go, well, we're never going to tell you. You're never going to know what it's 50% of. So again, obviously, If you're going to have transparency, you have to know what the total amount of money that's received is so that you can calculate transparently what 50% might be. Licensing rate. You have non-disclosure agreements now between Spotify, the labels, and other parties. Again, the creators themselves never know how much money has been generated by their work. Cost structures, deductions, hidden costs, I think that speaks for itself. And advances have become a huge issue now, too, because there was a case, and we're going to talk about it, I guess, in our direct licensing panel this afternoon, called DMX, where the publisher got an advance that was equal to the 3 years of the deal. Well, if you get an advance, the publisher gets 100% advance on what they think the deal will be worth over 3 years. That money will never go to any of the music creators. Because most of our contracts say, if you get an advance for the whole catalog, you don't share it with any individual creator. So that's great business if you can get it, right? You just keep 100% of the money. And then when that three-year deal is up, you do another three-year deal and you get an advance for what you think that 3 years will generate in licensing fees. So again, these are the kind of problems that we hope this fair trade music system will address and work through. So transparency and fair competition go hand in hand. Music consumers and creators need to know who pays and who plays fair in the new and rapidly changing music landscape, and who does not. Once informed, they can then decide whom to do business with and whom they may wish to avoid. Fair trade music will thus empower both creators and consumers with the knowledge they need to make informed decisions and will require no new legislation or regulation. So we're not calling for any changes to the Copyright Act. We're not calling for any new regulations. We're not against them if they're helpful to creators. But this is a proactive effort by 25,000 music creators around the world to get beyond this vicious cycle and downward spiral to some extent that we've been on for many years now. So fair trade music will work because millions of music consumers and music creators will know this symbol, and that's not necessarily the symbol, but I just did it anyway. A fair trade music company means that the people who make the music are properly benefiting wherever music is bought, streamed, downloaded, or otherwise enjoyed, and wherever music creators' monies are collected or distributed. And that this seal of approval, the fair trade music company, means that music creators themselves had played a key role in that determination. And I think I'd just like to leave you with that one thought. Everybody is involved with this discussion about what's fair compensation. What's fair to music creators? Don't music creators, aren't ultimately those of us who make the music, shouldn't we be part of the conversation? Should it really be lawyers and legislators and regulators, which it usually is? So I would argue strenuously, and thank you. And that's really all I have to say, so thank you very much.
In lieu of a question, can you tell them where they would go if they want to get involved in fair trade music?
The easiest place right now is probably the Songwriters Association, although we do have musiccreatorsalliance.com is up as well. Musiccreatorsalliance.com, just the three words. Or also there's links at the Songwriters Association of Canada, www.songwriters.ca. Has the SGA got a link up, Charlie? Okay, so there's links also at the Songwriters Guild of America website.
Awesome, thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Okay, so I got a little bit of housekeeping here to do, and then we're going to go eat food. Thanks to all the panelists this morning. Let's see, what do we got here? Network space is open all day if you need a beverage break to recharge your device or to check your email on the free Wi-Fi. And do please join our friend Paul Rapp for his Band as a Business workshop from 12:30 to 2 today in the networking space. He's probably already there and all lonesome, so go say hi. If you're watching via our webcast, we're going to take a short break for lunch. You can tune back in at 2 p.m. from one of our breakout sessions, just one of them here on the main stage. The breakout sessions start at 2 p.m. here and in the conference center, and all the information about where those are happening are located in your printed programs. Lastly, we wanted to let you know that there is still time to get in on the Future of Music Honors and Jail Guitar Doors benefit show tonight. The information is at the registration desk. Just leave them your name and your contact information, and we'll get you on a waiting list for tonight's show because it's going to be incredible. Okay, have a great lunch, guys. We'll see you at 2:00.